Hey everyone, welcome back to the channel. In today's video, we are going to talk about ComfyUI updates for the month of May 2024. There were a lot of updates throughout the year, but in this video, I'm going to cover only the month of May 2024. And also, I will only cover ComfyUI as the base ComfyUI project. Not any custom nodes, anything made by the community is not covered in this video. Maybe for a future video, we'll see. Let's get started. New features and support. We now have a webcam node. You can find it by right-clicking, selecting Add Node, going into Image, and then you will see Webcam Capture. If you add the node at the top, depending on your browser, you will get a notification asking you to allow webcam access. It may also be referred to as camera access, depending on your browser. Now, if you click on denied, maybe by accident or intentionally, you will see a notification telling you that it's unable to connect to webcam and permission is required. Now, once again, depending on your browser, you will need to go back to your permissions. For me, I can simply click at the top and allow. Once allowed, the capture will appear as a live feed. You can click on capture to get that specific frame. And if you want to use that frame in your workflow, you may want to add a preview node or connect it to a VAE encode and then use that there. Now you will still need to click on the cue prompt to send the image across the workflow. Now it is important to note that after capturing the image, your webcam will still be on. Even if you delete the node, even if you clear the workflow. The only way I found to deactivate the webcam is to click at the top and just refresh the page. So be sure to check whether your webcam is on or off, especially if you added the webcam node, captured the frame, and then you're spending 30 minutes building your workflow. Even without the webcam node, the webcam will remain activated. So once you've captured the frame, just refresh the page and double check. Now the next section is about a new model, the SDXS model, and here's the project. It's real-time one-step latent diffusion model with image conditions. And I know that we have a lot of one-step diffusion models, but this is just another one. And right now, ComfyUI has added support to detect and identify those models. As of now, we have two models, the 512 and the 1024 model. It's basically similar to SD1.5 and SDXL models. I will leave a link to this page in the description below for more details. If you would like to test the model, you can go to the link in the description below, click on files and versions, then click on unit, download the Diffusion Python model. It's about 1.26 gigabyte. Then go back into files and versions, download the text encoder model. And lastly, you may want to download the VAE as well. There are two versions, the small one, which is about 10 megabytes, and the large version, which is about 400 megabytes. You will require all three files. Actually, you will require the unit and the clip or the text encoder. The VAE, you can use the default SD1.5 version. Once you've downloaded them, go into ComfyUI Models for the unit version, place it in the unit folder. The VAE will go inside the VAE folder, and then the text encoder model will go inside the clip folder. Once you have all three, go back to ComfyUI, load a workflow. In my case, I am going to use a default workflow. Now, instead of using the load checkpoint node, we are going to add three nodes. The first one is the unit loader. This is going to be for the model. So it connects to the key sampler. The next one is load clip, and this one connects to the positive and negative prompt. And lastly, you can use a VA loader. In my case, I'm going to use the default SD 1.5 version. I found that I get better result using the default VA. Experiment to find what works best for you. Now, if you leave everything as is and you click on generate, you'll end up with a mess. This model requires one step. As for the CFG, the paper suggests or uses a CFG of 0. I found that 1 works best for me. Experiment on your own. Definitely check different CFG as well as step counts. As you can see, it is really fast and we get good images. Now, as of now, we have 2 base models. They are similar to SD 1.5 and SDXL. One can generate 512 and the other one can generate images of resolution 1024. Now, additionally, there are a few updates. We have a Dream Shaper model. There's the base version, the sketch version, as well as an anime version. You can download and test these models at your own pace and let me know if you enjoy these models. User experience enhancements. Previously on Windows, you could press Ctrl plus Delete to clear the canvas instead of clicking the Clear button. This shortcut has been removed. We now need to use Ctrl plus Backspace to clear the canvas. Once you press Ctrl plus Backspace, it will ask you to confirm whether you want to clear the workflow. If you are used to Ctrl plus Delete, you'll just need to switch to Ctrl Backspace. It's going to be a slight learning curve there. There is also a new feature or a new button, Reset View. Let's make as if you have a large workflow with nodes scattered around. Clicking the Reset View, it zooms and centers on this blue outline, making navigation easier. All right, next we have better zoom control. I'm sure you know by now that you can use the mouse wheel to zoom in and out. But if you do not have a mouse wheel, let's say you are using a laptop with a trackpad, instead of using gestures, you can use Ctrl plus Shift and then drag up to zoom in, drag down to zoom out. Now, some of you may have tried the shortcut key, Ctrl and the plus key, but doing that will zoom the entire browser, making everything bigger. We now have Alt and the plus key. This will zoom just the canvas. And if you use the Alt and the minus key, it will zoom out. Next one is for masking or inpainting. Now, when you use the default mask editor, and I'm talking about the default one, not a custom node or community added one. If you have the impact pack, you will get SAM editor, but I'm not talking about those. I'm talking about the default mask editor. Now, once you go in, you will see that before they've added a thickness slider, we now have an opacity slider as well. It makes it easier to see where you are actually painting. By the way, you can also change the color of the paint. It goes from black, white, as well as negative. Now, next one is about nodes again, but it's for the widgets. So when creating workflows, sometimes converting the widgets to inputs is easier, especially if you need to connect one output to multiple inputs. When you right-click on a node, for example, the key sampler, before you would get the option to convert seed to input. Now you will have to go into convert widget to input. You will get a submenu and in there you will see a list of all the widgets you can convert to inputs. Similarly, if you are converting from input to widgets, you will get the list and then you can select from there. The next one is for LoadLora Node, and the range for the slider has been increased from minus 100 to plus 100. Better workflow and conditioning. Let's simulate downloading some workflows from an online source. Let's make as if you have a .json file, you have a ComfyUI generated image, and then you also have an image that you've downloaded online. The JSON file was created using ComfyUI. The ComfyUI image was also generated by ComfyUI, which means it has the metadata embedded in it. Now the last one, a screenshot, is just a screenshot image. It does not have any metadata in it. So here in ComfyUI, let's say I want to load these files. I can drag the workflow.json file into ComfyUI and it will load as you would expect it. Next, I can drag the image which was previously generated by ComfyUI, and this one as well loads the workflow. Now, if I drag the screenshot into ComfyUI, I get this nice indication that tells me the screenshot does not have a workflow in it. Previously, it wouldn't do anything. It would just leave me unsure whether the canvas was updated or not. I would have to refresh the page and check the workflow manually to see if something changed. Now, the next enhancement is related to conditioning nodes, and that got improved a little bit. If you previously had images using these conditioning nodes, you can maybe try it again and see if there are any changes. Performance improvements. The first part focuses on speed enhancement. Now, if you're one of those people who likes to go into the manager and set a preview method, the latent to RGB method is now better. It has been improved and it is now even faster than before. So you may see a little bit of speed up when using it. The next speed up involves two nodes. If you use the image sharpen or image blur nodes, by the way, these are the default nodes built in ComfyUI. These two nodes were also improved, so you may see a speed up when using them. And of course, I'm not talking about 1, 2, or 3 seconds speed up, but it should still be noticeable. Next one is about using upscale models. So ComfyUI's resource management will now automatically allocate or free memory based on how much VRAM you have. This was default behavior, but it's now better. Now, next one involves those on low-end systems. If you have low VRAM, before ComfyUI was detecting that and it changes the VRAM state to a low VRAM by default. Now, with the new update, ComfyUI will detect it, but it will set the VRAM state to normal. So if you are affected by this, if you're not able to generate images, if you're getting out of memory errors, you may want to change this behavior back to low VRAM. You just need to edit the run NVIDIA GPU file. You can use Notepad and add --low VRAM at the end. And just as a bonus, you can also add --always_normal_VRAM if you want it to always be normal VRAM, regardless of the memory available. Okay, now let's talk about optimization and compatibility. If you have an Intel GPU, there have been significant improvements. Previously, Intel GPU support was mostly in beta or trial stage, but now it's fully integrated and the GitHub repository provides instructions on installing the drivers and setting it up correctly. Next one involves the system login. Now, in the terminal, you will see even more logs as if it was not enough, but some of these logs are actually useful. It tells you whether there's a missing node, broken workflows, and so on. I was not able to simulate these to provide screenshot, but in code, it's going to look like this. It will also display the Python version, the PyTorch version, and other relevant information. Now, lastly, we have some bug fixes. The first one is for Mac users. Sometimes when you were generating images, you would get a black image. That was a bug, now it got fixed. The next one is for ControlNet. So previously, or for those on low-end system, when loading a control net model, it would sometimes take more memory than required. And some of you may have experienced that the control net would not upcast to the correct precision level. Now, this got fixed, so you may want to check back again and see if your workflow is working now. This one mostly affects new installation or ComfyUI. The download package got updated. Basically, in the requirements.py, we have the correct NumPy version added to the file. So this ensures that the NumPy version is always correct. And last for today, there were issues reported by users when loading JPEG or PNG images, and that got fixed as well. All right, so that was it. Thank you for watching until the very end. Let me know if you got any speed up or any improvements by upgrading to the latest version. Thank you for watching. I will see you in the next one.